Council here on Monday, August 27th. We're going to have an invocation this evening from
Pastor Isaiah Adio.
Pastor Isaiah Elliott, right?
Adio.
Adio, okay. Before that, we're going to ask everyone to stand up, and we're going to have a brief moment of silence for Senator John McCain, and then we'll ask the pastor to lead us into the invocation.
Let us pray. Father, in Jesus' name, Father, Lord, we thank you, Lord, for your presence everywhere, anytime. Father, Lord, we are asking you, Lord, let your presence be with us this evening in the name of Jesus. Let your name alone be glorified. Thank you, Lord, for your full presence. Thank you, Lord, for your Holy Spirit in our midst. As we pray in Jesus' name, amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Ms. Goodman-Henrichetz?
Here.
Mr. Marmorou?
Here.
Ms. Reed?
Here.
Ms. Schehelneck?
Here.
Mr. Slifko?
Here.
Mr. Twyman?
Present.
Mr. Waltman, president.
Here.
Seven present, none absent.
All right, we had an executive session on August 20th, and that was regarding litigation and contracts. Just wanted to announce that. We have no proclamations this evening. And we're going to go into the public comment period. We have
one that says award of contracts, so
we'll just consider that an agenda.
Yeah. And then there are three, I believe, that are non.
All right, Council, we have one agenda item regarding speakers and three non-agenda. Any problem hearing them at this time? If not, Donna, do you mind reading our public comment policy, please?
City Council welcomes citizens' comments. We note that any person addressing an agenda issue has 5 minutes to make their remarks. Those commenting on general matters have 3 minutes. No comments shall be made from any location except the podium. If you have any materials to share with Council, our city auditor is right there. Please hand those materials to him, and he will be happy to distribute them to council members. All remarks must be directed to council as a body and not to any individual council member or public or elected official in attendance. Any person making personally offensive or impertinent remarks, or any person becoming unruly while addressing council, may be called to order by the presiding officer and may be barred from speaking before council unless permission to continue speaking is granted by majority vote of council. I believe today we have two gentlemen who are here to be able to translate. If we have any primarily Spanish-speaking guests who wish to address council, and to that I'll send it over to the president.
Okay, our first speaker this evening is Zia and Edward Mahmood, and the topic is weekly flea market at North 9th Street. Good evening. You can both come to the podium. This is a non-agenda item, so you have up to about 3 minutes, okay? If you could pull that microphone down just a little bit so we can hear you.
There you go. A very pleasant good evening to you all, ladies and gentlemen. This is my first appearance before an august body like yours. So if I misspeak, please forgive me because of standing in front of you all, you know. I may have a tendency, you know, to misspeak, so forgive me for that. I have this piece of paper that I should have brought copies because I was not familiar with the protocol, so I have this written everything, you know. We are a charitable organization, 501c3, as this piece of paper states. Reverb Concerts, located on 1339 Street, has been very generous to donate their parking lot. They have two big parking lot for flea market. We are not asking for any zoning injunction, you know, permanent zoning. We are asking just a flea market where people who have their one man's junk is another man's treasure. So within city limits, there is no flea market. So we are asking for Saturday or Sunday, only between the months of April and October, months of April and October, only on Saturdays or Sundays. And all the proceeds would go to the charitable donations, charitable foundations, mission work, you know, within the city limits, you know. And other than that, all we are asking, anything else we are, I have forgotten. Mm-hmm. No, that's about the size of it. Thank you, gentlemen. God bless you. And I was very much impressed, you know, that the meeting started with the word of prayer. God bless you all.
Thank you very much. And there will be an opportunity for council to make a comment after our public speaking period. Our next speaker is Fatima Camaro, and the topic is the Beauty with Brains Foundation. And this is a non-agenda item, so Fatima, welcome, and you have up to 3 minutes, okay?
Good evening, council. My name is Fatima Camaro, and I'm 17 years of age.
And my name is Mobilawa Audio, and I'm also 17 years of age.
And we are here to present our nonprofit organization to City Council called Beauty with Brains Foundation. We started this organization because we've realized that keeping your dreams as a child and turning them into reality can be difficult when you have people in your ear. So we decided to create an environment in which girls ranging from 5th to 8th grade can come and feel free to share their dreams and aspirations without them being tarnished or crushed.
Within this organization, we plan to bring about confident, skilled leaders through real-life discussions, help build academic skills through tutoring and educational projects, and also help the young girls better themselves with opportunities such as listening to motivational speakers. We are located at the Redeemed Christian Church of God, Jesus is Alive World Center at 851 North 11th Street. And our sessions will be held on Wednesdays and Fridays from 5 to 6:30. Our first session will begin September 12th of next month. Thank you for your time.
Thank you very much. Our next speaker is Mr. Juan Zabala, and the topic is award of contracts. And Juan, good evening, sir. You have up to 5 minutes.
Good evening, Council. Here, I'm read this what I wrote. So, how do we award city contracts? I've been asking this for quite some time, and I've yet to get a clear answer on that. I was told that we do it based on a point system, but I would be interested in knowing how that rubric works. I often wonder, in a majority-minority city, how many contracts not only go to people of color, but to local city residents. One of the biggest setbacks in communities like ours is that we have fallen victim to the suburbanization of our great community. We have fallen victims to this belief that we live in a poor city, but at the last council meeting, I saw that the city gave out nearly $500,000 to organizations that were not in the city of Reading. We gave money that did not hire local residents and who do not have a vested interest in our community or communities like ours. This is how we keep losing to our suburban counterparts. I remember a time when most police officers lived in the city, and although public safety is a component of a police officer living in the city, it's not everything. Another reason that it is important to have police officers live in the city is because of the living wages that they are afforded for working for our community. What is occurring is that people are allowed to make the money, their money here, but not only, but not obligated to keep their money here. It takes money to create money. So when restaurants and private sector employers look to places to start businesses, they look for how much discretionary income people have. They find this by what the median income is of the area. If the median incomes are low, then most companies and businesses find other destinations to start their businesses. If private business can't come into our community, then we have to do everything through the power of government. The question we should be asking is, how do we use government to empower the private sector to help our citizens find jobs and create small business that will be able to scale up? My idea is we need local mandates that force companies that are, who are doing business with the city of Reading to allocate 35% or more of the awarded contracts to employ city residents. If they don't need our $250,000, I'm sure there will be someone else who will need it. If we use the example of the $500,000 that was awarded at the last meeting to outside companies, we would have, and if we would have allocated 35% of that to our community, we would have generated $175,000 that would have stayed local and allocated to city residents here in the city of Reading. We can continue to keep giving our opportunity, away for nothing. We're building the Buttonwood Gateway on the basis of low-income housing. When we were voting for this in the Redevelopment Authority, some of my fellow members at the time said, "Something is better than nothing." Is that our redevelopment, our economic development model? Something is better than nothing. When citizens do not have property rights, they do not vote. When we continue to concentrate poverty, we are ultimately limiting the prospect for kids in our community to be afforded a better education. We are adding to a depreciating housing stock by adding new luxury style rentals. In a marketplace where median rents are $650 to $700 for a 1 to 3 bedroom house, we are adding inventory that is low income. It's the basic principle of supply and demand. If low-income housing was so important to everybody, then why aren't they putting the low-income housing in West Reading where families are priced out of the housing market and median rents will be in the thousands of dollars for similar housing that you get in the city? It's like Berks County uses the city of Reading as a dumping ground for poverty. Instead of tax-producing entities, we find a way to create tax liabilities. A fire station in the southeast section of the city is needed. But a fire station on a commercial corridor is counterintuitive to what a commercial corridor was intended to be. We don't make it easy for small business to start, but we are taking land that could be developed to create private sector jobs and creating public sector jobs that would be funded by an already shrinking inner city middle class. We prioritize churches that will not create tax revenue over small business that could generate taxes and be a start for immigrant families that typically come into inner cities. You kill our middle class and tax them like they are wealthy. I'll be honest, sometimes it feels like we create the poverty on purpose, as if as long as the city of Reading is poor, then the people from outside the city can continue to deplete all of our resources. This in itself is a crime. Put the city of Reading first. Police officers who live in the city, incentive for teachers so that we can increase the educational attainment of the people in our community. Mandating 35% of city contracts are awarded to city residents. That we focus our efforts to help award contracts to historically disenfranchised groups that make up the majority of our city residents, using the tax incentive programs to help start up minority and women developers to partner with other developers as co-developers. I'm almost done. I'm wrapping it up, yeah. Creating tax incentives for minority-owned and women-owned developers to work with developers who are getting city tax credits or incentives through the city, and having them work as co-developer. This is something that Newark, New Jersey does, and other cities have tried in the past. If they want to abandon us, meaning those that don't want to live here, let them. We just can't abandon ourselves. Build your people. Thank you.
Thank you, Juan. And our final speaker this evening, is it George Davis? George? And the topic is lantern fly. Good evening, George. Sir, you have up to 3 minutes, okay?
My name's George Davis. I like to say I'm an artist, photographer, Capricorn, humanist, computer nerd, and metamorph. The plant, but a plant person also. So what I'm presenting tonight is my opinion on the lantern fly. I just had a few words with Glenn in the bathroom, if you'll forgive the phrase. He informs me about the idea of what the city has for doing about the lantern fly. One thing, this is my solution, which is canola oil and dish detergent, plain dish detergent. So I heard that they're going to be using alcohol as a way to combat the fly. The problem with alcohol is you can't do that with it. This is completely harmless. You can use it on any surface. You can spray it in your child's face. It's completely harmless. But that's not the biggie about the lantern fly. If you start using alcohol, you're going to poison your environment. This is the thing that I'm trying to work against, stopping people from poisoning the environment. If you use, if you destroy the trees that these flies use, they automatically jump to other trees. They prefer the sumac, but that doesn't mean they won't use the other trees. Now, the other point I want to make is anybody taking a real good look at the lantern fly? Has anybody considered the fact that this might not be a fly, which is why you're having so much trouble eradicating it? That this might actually be somebody else's idea of a minion, a type of bioweapon that's being used against us? No, I didn't think anybody thought about that part. Because we're looking at an insect that not only, let me get to another part. Remember anybody who tried to step on a lantern fly? Yeah, you can't step on them. And you wonder why you can't step on them. Because they have a number of hairs on their back that act as static electricity. When you step on them, that compresses those hairs, which the static electric compresses that hair, which causes them to jump out from under. And if you step up to them again and step on them, you got the same problem. It takes at least 4 steps in order to be able to kill an lantern fly stepping on it. I don't know if anybody noticed that. But the major point is, 1 minute. The major point is there's an easy way to take care of the lantern fly. This is just canola oil and water. It's not a poison. You can spray this all day long and it doesn't hurt anything that doesn't breathe. It doesn't hurt anything that doesn't breathe through its butt. Now, when you spray this on something, it does take a few minutes for it to be able to kill the fly, but it does work. Now, like I said before, we should start looking at the fact that we might be in a bad situation here because we're going to cause these insects to spread out more. Thank you.
Thank you, George. Okay, that concludes our public speakers this evening. As normal, we open it up if there's any need for an immediate comment from council. We will also have an opportunity at the end of the meeting. Does anybody have an immediate need to respond to any of the speakers this evening? John.
Just very briefly, with the couple here about the flea market, I might request that you speak to our managing director here, who might be able to alert you as to any zoning problems or non-problems that might exist for your situation. But I think while you're here, you can get a helpful answer from our managing director.
We are not asking for zoning.
Okay.
Okay.
Mayor?
Jeff, incidentally, you're both doctors. Okay, you have a doctorate degree, and you certainly are one of the best eye surgeons, I think, on the whole Eastern Coast, Dr. Edna Mahmood, okay? They did just come in to see me, and the problem was that they don't have a distinction between flea markets and yard sales at the city of Reading under the ordinance. So they would have to go, and they're allowed three, I think it is, a year that they can do. And what they were looking for was to do it every one day a week for those months you talked about. They weren't making any money for themselves. They were raising it. They didn't want to go spend the money for a zoning thing to find out if it could be done. What they were asking is there an ordinance you can adopt for a flea market, which is completely different from a yard sale? And I told them that they should go over and talk in zoning, which they did. And then after you were done talking to me, I said, the best place to come is here, right? And to see if there's something that can be done to help them out. So both God-loving people, so.
I think what we can do is invite them to one of our committee of the whole meetings in the near future, talk about the ordinance as it exists and see what amendments might be available to accommodate something like that. So I'll ask Linda to reach out to you and Mahmoud's to invite them to our committee of the whole meeting. I'll discuss it with you. Any other comments?
I had one additional one for Mr. Zavala. You made a lot of good points. I'll only respond to one of them, and that is, according to our city charter, there is a premium or a discount of, I believe it's 10%, for contractors who are within the city of Reading. I don't know, I'm not familiar with our purchasing procedures and all its nuances, but that is a possible provision that could be an incentive for contractors within the city to apply for city contracts.
All right, Marcia.
And again, on that same topic that Mr. Zavala pointed out, I do remember we did enact an ordinance that had to do with minority and women-owned businesses. What we need to do is bring that back, because there's different people sitting at the table here, different administrations, and indeed, I believe there was some incentives for those types of businesses. So we need to make sure everyone's following what had been enacted.
Okay. Any other immediate comments? Glenn?
Well, since it's been raised, I was going to save it during the managing director's report. First of all, this has been explained to Mr. Zavala at the Reading Redevelopment Authority that we do have a portion of our rating system for minority and women businesses, which is 5%. One of the problems that we find with a lot of small contractors and even big contractors occasionally, they can't qualify for a bond. And most of our projects require bond and insurance for the city, because one of our contractors went out of business for the wastewater treatment plant, and the bonding company stepped in, brought a company in to take over that project. Even if a business is not technically located in the city, they are still required to get a BPL, business privilege license, and pay business property tax, a BPT, to do business in the city. And this was all explained when we've discussed this numerous times at the Reading Redevelopment Authority, and there is a rating sheet. And in fact, the price, depending on the bid, is a separate bid after we do an evaluation based on the experience of the players that are involved, and only then is the price added, which counts 15% for that. As to the Buttonwood project, I don't remember, you know, who or if anybody said something is better than nothing. The Buttonwood Gateway project has been under discussion by the Reading Redevelopment Authority long before I started on the board, as a way to do an improvement to the Buttonwood Gateway area with a developer that was very successful on, was it Weiser Street, bringing in much needed market rate housing for people that are looking for quality housing and also efficient housing, because the Weiser Street housing is very energy efficient. And the developer is also looking at wrapping his project around the existing houses that are there to do also facade improvements and improvements to the general area. And the city has made a commitment to do infrastructure, which you all were part of that discussion, as a way to revitalize that section of the city. Now, Mr. Zavala is a realtor, I understand that. So his interest is in selling houses, individual housing, to people. And there is nothing wrong with that, but there is a healthy need for quality rental housing, and especially as many of the millennials in particular, after watching what their parents went through with the downturn and the Great Recession, and this has all been talked about at the Redevelopment Authority, are looking more for rental housing than they are, purchasing a home, because they want to have the flexibility if a job ends that they can move and not be tied down with the house. So this has been a big discussion on the board about property and getting people involved. Mr. Zavala has brought every meeting somebody to come to meet with the board, and the board has been very open to talk with them. In fact, there were two realtors there recently, and I spoke to at least one of them after the fact to give him an idea where he might be able to find housing units to actually sell on our vacant property list. So I just want to make sure that is out in the public.
Okay. I want to remind everyone this is kind of a brief response period, so any other critical comments?
Briefly, I wanted to wait to address, and I will address at the end, but I want to commend Mr. Zavala for coming, bringing these things to attention. I think there's certainly things that happen in our past, and sometimes we go ahead and make the right decisions, but they don't follow through. There's been mention that the administration's changed, which is very true, but certain things like minority contracts and keeping money within the city, those are viable ideas that need to be at the top of our list when we go to contracting. So I believe that bringing them to the public is a great idea, and the questions can be answered through metrical studies. We can go back and review what has happened, and that's why I often push for STAR, which is soon to be a LEED program in the city, because it has metrical data that can be reviewed, not just said that something happened. We can all look at it, transparency of each system, and realize what actually happened. And I think those are some great points by Mr. Zavala. So please, I always encourage further involvement from our constituents, and never get deterred because you feel like you may not have got the right answer. But just as long as you're heard, it's very important. So I'll speak later.
Sir, did you have a comment?
Well, I was going to speak later, but I'll bring it up now. Mr. Zavala, I know you for quite a few years, okay? I'm one of the biggest pushers on this council for the last 10 years in regards to the hiring of police officers from minority groups. We just cannot get them to come forth and sign those papers to get chosen. And there's something wrong. I mean, even the fire department, I used to get with the chief there. They weren't coming. And then we went out and put a big push on. They still wouldn't come on. Someone needs to talk to them. And I always give the example. You get a guy that becomes a police officer from the city of Reading. He knows the city. There's nothing wrong with hiring outsiders. But even when this gentleman came down from Scranton in regards to the problem that we were involved with, and we were placed on the that act for
Act 47.
47. He said, make sure that you bring up that they should be hiring city people instead of outsiders. I don't know what percentage of police officers or firemen live in the city anymore. That's bad. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, everyone. We're going to move on to the approval of our agenda in minutes. That includes tonight's agenda with the withdrawal of Bill number 34-2018 and Bill number 48-2018. as requested by the administration and the parking authority. It will also, with the approval of our agenda, would include the minutes from our August 13th regular meeting and our August 20th special meeting. It would also include the consent agenda items, which includes the following two items. First is an award of contract for the preparation of the regulatory requirements for environmental review records for the 2019 to 2023 Community Development Block Grant Home Investment Partnership Program, the Emergency Solutions Grant, and the Section 108 Loan Guarantee Programs at the cost of $9,135. It would also include a resolution appointing Jeffrey Waltman Sr. as the council representative on the Downtown Revitalization Public-Private Partnership Board of Directors and Lucine Sahelnik as the alternate. Did I pronounce your name right? Yeah, I did. Okay.
Oh, good.
So those two items would be approved as well. Is there any objection to the approval of our agenda with those amendments, the minutes, and the two consent agenda items at this time? If there's no objection, they are all approved. We're going to move on then to the administrative report. And we'll start off by welcoming the Honorable Mayor Scott for any comments he has this evening.
Hi, good evening. As you all saw, and I've read many times, the Auditor General's report on the Reading School District and the help that they received, not only from him, but from that group that's out there. I'm trying to think, I can't think of it now, but BCIU, and them sending people into work to get the books in order and to make an arrangement there. I want to first share with you that on the day that the Auditor General was here, Dan Kelly, who's sitting over there, called the mayor's office asking how I felt about audits for the different authorities. And we told him, obviously, that we're definitely in favor of it for everything, redevelopment authority, parking authority, water authority. And if there's one I missed, and we'll look at that. But not just those authorities. I contacted board members. Everybody's agreed to do it back then, okay? One thing that, you know, we're not looking at is you folks, our government here. When I first came on this board, I tried to get a forensic audit on the wastewater treatment plant, and I was told nothing. And I was told by you, Jeff, to basically get something together and let you know what it was that we were looking for exactly. And my thing when I discussed it with you before, after that, was that it was still the wastewater treatment plant and the amount of money that was lost there. What's interesting to me is I see our past employees testifying there, and some of them were the problem with the wastewater treatment plant. And what I'm going to ask you is that a possibility that, I mean, there's a lot of things you can look at, but we're a big government. This sewer plant problem and some of the things that were approved by, and I say, when I say this to you, let me say this to you quickly. Glenn here took a deposition from different people. I'll be the first one to say that the people that were building that water plant kept it away from you. And they basically stated it in their deposition on what the cost was and what was going on. And I really think we have to go there and we have to take a look at it. And I hear one council person always talking about fiduciary responsibility. Fiduciary responsibility is to each one of us that we represent people, we represent the city, and that we have to do this. And I'm going to ask you once again, if you don't want to do a forensic audit, would you consider getting together and inviting the Auditor General to come here and take a look at this wastewater treatment plant and the millions of dollars we've lost in it that we'll never get back? And it isn't your fault, because in what I read and in the depositions that were taken by Glenn, these people kept it away from you and they allowed it to go on. And I see the very same people testifying under oath, and I don't mean to pick on who they're testifying to, because I don't judge people like that, nor do I knock them into the gutter. But I heard some comments that if the newspaper is accurate, aren't exactly the same comments they gave us in a deposition. So I'm really looking to find out if while the Auditor General is capable of doing this, that we do this quickly so that we could get them, and at the same time notify the prosecutors in this case that they have before them in Philadelphia, because some of those comments I read aren't the ones that I read before. And I think that it's something we need to do. So I would ask if you would all, and I can tell you real quick, again, as I said before, they've already stated that they've kept it from you. They didn't want you to know what it was costing. But I really think you should make up a letter, and we should invite the Auditor General to come down and to do an audit on this wastewater treatment plant and all the millions we lost on it. If you could do that, please. The last thing is I wanted to talk to you about all the homeless people that are in the city of Reading. Many of the homeless have mental problems. They're challenged there. I see that you had passed an ordinance where years ago where you didn't want any more rooming houses. But the problem that we have here is that you have a larger population of homeless people that are walking around that are used to being institutionalized, and they need that chair, they need that bed, they need that bathroom. But more important than that, they need a place that's clean and has dignity to it. Right now you have so many rooming houses that are out there that people just close their eyes to, because where would these people live, and a substandard living conditions for poor people. But they grab great rates of money from $60 to $90 per room per week. And the average person that's out on the street can get from the federal government and also from the state somewhere anywhere from $311 up to about $711 to $811 a month. But they don't want to live in an apartment. And I've talked to many of them, and I'd like you to go back and please take a look at maybe how we could get an ordinance that would allow good, clean, up to codes rooming houses for people who really depend on it, have no way of judging it themselves, but to guarantee them that where they lay their head is very safe. And I would like to have a discussion with you on it, if you would please consider doing that. But outside of that, that's where we're at. Most important is every authority we have already reached out, but I really would appreciate if you would give us a letter of recommendation or make a letter of recommendation to the Auditor General to come in here and audit the wastewater treatment plant project, please.
Okay, before anyone comments to the mayor, I just want to mention that that issue was litigated. I'm not opposed to the Auditor General coming in and taking a deeper dive with it, Mayor.
Glenn did tell me, we both agree on this. The company we really would like to see audited is Black & Veatch.
Yeah, okay. And I don't know that you even need a letter from council to request the State Auditor General to do that.
Does he come here now? I mean, he goes to all the, you're saying yeah. that he needs for the authorities. Welcome.
Yeah, it's perfectly, I know that was litigated and there was, necessarily pleased with the results.
Yeah,
but
we had to walk away from it because of the fact, to be quite honest with you, before I ever got here and before Glenn ever got here, and he may tell me that I shouldn't say this, but how could we go any further when it's our own people that sabotaged it? And we need these people to be held accountable. And if there's fiduciary responsibility, it was there, and it cost us millions and millions of dollars. That civil suit has nothing to do with the audit.
Yeah, and Mayor, I don't think you need a letter from City Council to initiate that. If you want one, we can certainly entertain discussing that at our next available meeting and get back to you.
Does anybody know here, do you know whether, does the Auditor General need an invitation from us, like the authorities did?
Well, I would think he needs a formal request, and if you would like a resolution from City Council, to me that makes more sense than us even requesting one of the parking authority. But we'll discuss it, and we'll get back to you on a formal resolution.
I was hoping you'd do it quickly, because I'm telling you, some of the testimony I heard against the prior mayor doesn't ring right to me.
Okay.
From we'll people do, on his sewage treatment plan.
We'll discuss
what
it.
What I read doesn't ring right.
I'll talk to the body. We'll get back to you by the end of the week.
I thank you.
All right. Any other comments for the mayor on these issues? Marcia?
Okay, and I appreciate, Mayor, your concern for the homelessness. Unfortunately, in Berks County, we have a strong organization the Coalition to End Homelessness that actually has a plan for that. So what I suggest is maybe that you attend one of their meetings to bring forth what your concerns are, and they can be explaining to you the different kinds of programs and such. What's important for homeless, and you pointed out the mental illness and, of course, substance abuse disorders with many of them, is they require the type of housing where the primary problem for their homelessness is addressed at the same time that they're provided with shelter. So that's why we have a coalition, and I would really encourage you to reach out to them, and I would ask council to be able to look at that before we move ahead with anything, and look at the monies that have been invested by the city for homelessness programs through both our community development block grant and other governmental funding.
Could I just please respond to that? And I agree with you, the Coalition and Homelessness is a great organization, but what would make you think I haven't called them? They have no place for the people. They don't have the funds, they don't have the properties, they're limited, and they'll tell you right out, homelessness in Reading is unbelievable.
Oh, yeah.
But it might be the same way someplace else. But one way we did agree when I talked to the woman there, if we had rooming houses that were basically legal, up to codes, set up as a rooming house, almost like the old, I'm thinking of the Daniel Boone Hotel, they called it, that was up next to the Park Theater years ago. It was just one room, had a bathroom inside of it. You remember, Scott? And it had lattice on the doors and everything. And it really took care of those people. When these people come to town here, all they have to make themselves feel good, okay, is drugs. That's what helps them sleep at nighttime. They get this is like going wild. This is just a small step, but it's a necessity that we need. And even though, you know, the public, the council is against, you would like more home ownership and all that stuff. In this particular case, these people just need the ability to sleep somewhere safe, clean, and they have some dignity when they walk out the door, and they can go back and their room is still there. We don't have that here in Reading. The couple of hotels that we have that are rooming houses, if you went into them, I don't even want to tell you what it's like there, what it smells like. And they've got their licenses, but they meet the bare minimums of what's required. And they really do take advantage of those people that basically need help mentally. And we have to help out. I mean, we have to step up to the plate. Wintertime is coming. They have nowhere to go. And we're going to run into the same problems we had last year, where do you go with them? It's almost like we are put up tents and put heating units in just to give them a safe place to sleep. I just want to share this with you. I did meet with Dr. Mahmood, and I met also with the principal from Upper Reading High School on the homelessness of children, okay, and where they're going. And I didn't get a chance, but you talk about, like, the parking authority. You know, these people sleep in cars, and they sleep anywhere they can, and they're really in a position where they could be attacked, they could be broken into, anything could happen. One child stays awake while the rest of them sleep. And I was thinking, and I must first say this, that I'm sure the parking authority would be in favor of it. I'm thinking about we ought to find a parking garage that we know is empty at nighttime and offer them a place to go park and sleep. And when wintertime comes, we're going to have a big, big problem. And it's not gotten any better. It's gotten worse in our community. Thank you. I'm just so adamant about it. I wish I had enough money to provide them all sleeping places that they can go to. But these rooming houses that are even legal, they're horrible.
Mm-hmm. All right.
We got to do something.
Brian?
Two comments. First, Mayor, I think that if the homelessness issue is an issue, we would love to have you at the Committee of the Whole to take some time as much as you need to talk about it. I think sometimes at the public meetings, it's not the right appropriate time because we have so much to do and a lot has already been established. As to the other issue related to the audit for the wastewater treatment plant, I think that's fine, but I don't want to move the ball or just distract from what we're talking about. We're proposing the Reading Parking Authority and the other authorities' reports because that is the here and now. These issues are kind of on the table as we speak. The wastewater treatment plant, we're already building a new set of procedures to do that, and I think we're through that. So I think if that's something that we want to do here, I'm certainly not against it, but I don't think that that should trump or move in front of what we're proposing with Mr. Pasquale and the audits of these authorities.
Well, I think personally that you're proposing something political because of the fact that we've already agreed to it long before you brought up your resolution for tonight. But let me just say this to you. Brian, you may not like the audit of the Parking Authority. You may not like it at all. And the reason I say that to you is because of the fact that all of us have done our best to help people here on this board and other people, but they're all part of the problem that's there. And I'm just asking you, instead of jumping in with something which is a political statement and wiping away, as you always say, don't worry about the past, worry about the future. The past has cost us where we are now in the future. And we're trying everything we can to do what's right. But I've just decided for the rest of this administration of mine, I'm not backing down from anybody. If you call me on the carpet, I will call you just as quickly, okay? I want you to understand that things must change and we have to do something besides what we want for ourselves and do things that belong to the people of this city of Reading.
So if you would refrain from stating my opinion as to what I'm doing and why I do it, I'd appreciate that. And secondly, there's no political agenda behind what I'm saying. I'm just dealing with the hearing.
There's
now.
No cause for what you're asking.
I'm going to ask you guys to.
Pardon me just a minute.
We're going to. We're going to move on.
I don't get here often. When you said that I should come to the committee of the hall, tell me the last time when I've asked you questions, anyone here has ever answered me. In the committee of the hall.
Well, we're going to stop. Please. We're going to stop the crossfire action for now, Wally.
But it is important.
I'm going to skate.
Wally, like surf over the real issues.
Wally, you got to let me.
You
got to let me conduct the meeting.
I will.
All right, Donna, and then anyone else after.
I'd like to know if we can, and I know it's something you wouldn't know off the top of your head, but how many rooming houses do we currently have in the city? If there are, in as bad shape as you contend they are, where are codes and where is the Department of Codes in terms of citing them, the State Department of Health if there are issues, Office of Aging, mental health offices here in the county. There are many, many, many organizations that are there to help us as a city. We're not an island. We should not stand alone, and we should ask for that help. None of us is the fixer. We all need help, and we all need to be collaborative with the folks around us. You know, I would like to see those numbers just as we would like to see numbers for other things. What is past is prologue. We need to know what happened in the past so we can make the future better. And that applies not only just to the authorities, but also applies to particular situations. You know, the homeless come here because the cost of living is so reasonable. They're here because so many in the past, going back to the 80s, illegal conversions and small apartments and rooms that are probably still not totally registered, give these people an opportunity to live and live inexpensively, which is good, but it's not good if codes aren't being followed. If one of these rooming houses, any of these that using it as an example, if there's a fire tomorrow, who does it fall on? Does it not fall on us for not holding up and making sure codes are enforced, quality of life issues are enforced? We can't just be harping on the fact that people are poor. We have to do something to raise them up. I like the idea that's come about through some of the folks that are sitting in this audience, as well as Mr. Poole at the DoubleTree, about these small homes that give homeless a place to start and let them build up. It's a little communities. If we have areas of the city that we have, major demolition, Latisse area, something like that. Why don't we create these small communities to give people a hand up, to step forward, attractive small places they can take pride in, and then move forward onto home ownership like Juan has been talking about. There are ways to do these things, but I think just saying we need more rooms without already fixing the problem is not going to help any of us.
Marcia, how do you fix the problem of homelessness?
Wally, let me
this is unbelievable.
Marcia,
know what it is.
Wally, please.
Aye.
Well, first of all, I agree with Councillor Twyman is that these issues are more appropriately dealt with the Committee of the Whole, and it certainly would be good to invite the Coalition to End Homelessness. They do, and I've been a part of this, they do a point-in-time count of the homelessness where I've gone out as a part of that team years past to be able to see where the homeless are. They do it a multiple number of times. So there is an accurate, not an accurate, but a point-in-time count, which is then used to be able to look at how we can leverage different funding. We have excellent organizations such as the Salvation Army, okay, the Hope Rescue Mission, absolutely, the Opportunity House, that have worked with governmental guidelines that provide the services that need. Is it sufficient? No, I don't think so. But again, let's talk to the people that have the expertise rather than being a reactionary response. We need to make informed decisions, and then we can look at different proposals.
Winter time is only 2 months away.
Wally, any other comments or questions to the mayor's report? If not, we're going to move on to the managing director for any comments, and then there will be an opportunity as well at the end of the meeting for any comments.
Next meeting. Well, obviously, we're getting ready to start preparing for snow, even though we're going to have a heat wave this week. But I just want to remind everybody, school is back in session. There's a lot of activity going on with UGI construction projects, with PennDOT construction projects going on through the city, and the city will start some of its road projects in the near future. To advise people to be cautious for the children. Just every year we have a hard time getting enough crossing guards, but they have been through a training session this year, so I just encourage everybody to be cautious when they're driving through the city. Sometimes it's taking a little longer to get where you want to go, so please just don't get foolish. So other than that, we have nothing to add right now.
Any questions for the managing director, Marcia?
Yeah, and I wanted to thank all those individuals that responded to. There is a concern, and it has to do with the timing of PennDOT work on intersections. This morning, I was there with good people from the church at 16th and Perkiomen, and also the crossing guard, who was outstanding in a very, very dangerous situation where the children couldn't cross the street onto a pavement because the curb work was being done. And that's maybe throughout the city. I'm not sure. I can only be responsive to what happens in the area that I'm responsible for. But it's a disaster waiting for happen. Let's say there is a problem at any one time and that crossing guard is not available to cross those children, I don't even want to think what happened. So I want to be able to look at what communication is being done with the Reading School District or with our police department if they do have people that call off sick at those very hazardous intersections to make sure there's someone there that's making sure the children can cross safely. Because again, they have no choice. They can't cross onto a pavement. They cross onto a street because the payments are inaccessible.
Any other comments? All right. Thank you. We're going to move on to our auditor's report. David, good evening, sir, and welcome.
Thank you, Council President. Good evening, one and all. Three items in my report this evening. First, monthly update on the admission fees or taxes. We received over $6,600 from the Reading Fighting Phils for July's ticket sales. Over 16,400 came in for various performances at the Santander Arena and Performing Arts Center. World Wrestling Entertainment was in, Straight No Chaser, Miranda Sings, just various performers that were in. We have yet to receive for July, once again, the Reading Royals contribution for advanced ticket sales. As of the end of July, $363,664.17, budgeted benchmark $460, and I provided month-to-date and year-to-date from 2014 to the present. Second monthly update, real estate transfer tax. There were 196 properties sold in the month of July. 163 were taxable. Taxable yield, our 3.5% levy, earned us $350,708.33. Through July, over $2.2 million of budgeted $3.3 million. So we're on target to exceed budget once again for the fifth consecutive year. and I also provided year-to-date actuals going back to January 14th. And lastly, last Wednesday, the 22nd, Councilwoman Goodman Henderson and I both attended the Reading Parking Authority meeting, which was held down on the first floor here in our pen room. The entire board of the Reading Parking Authority, their executive director, Mr. Thomas McDougall, and staff were very courteous, professional, and provided some financial reports as of July 31st, 18, and through mid-August of 2018 as well. The board expects to accept their 2017 annual audit at their September meeting. Both Councilwoman Goodman, Hinterschitz, and I believe we should be able to attend that meeting as well. There was an excellent discussion between the RPA board and executive director with us regarding keeping the lines of communications open with Mayor Scott's administration and also City Council. They also promised to provide on a monthly basis the same financial reports that their board is now getting. That is my brief report. I'm open for questions.
Okay, any comments or questions for the auditor? Mayor?
Tell me why the Royals have not paid you. I've read it in the newspaper why, but I'd like to hear it from you personally.
Why they haven't paid?
Why haven't they paid you?
Okay.
And they haven't paid you. And they don't
intend to. They haven't paid since February. You are correct. One of their finance people, after several phone calls over several months, put it this way. He believes the parking authority owes them money going back several
years. How much do you think?
Hold on, guys. I'm going to call to order. David.
This
Mayor.
Might be executive session, but
yeah,
I'll leave
we're going to end that discussion, guys.
How would that possibly be executive session when it's
a parking authority legal matter. I don't think
you make it look like the parking authority has done something wrong. I won't mention the
we're not going to get into the details of that legal matter. We can't. Okay. I know.
Well, my God, I'm reading about him and Albert Bosco every day in the paper. The biggest contributor.
Yeah, but
that no to pay to play game here. And I'm telling you, here's the price he
wants.
This
no.
is where they're at.
Wally.
It's come all the way down to that.
Wally.
So everything that you tell the public is not true.
Wally, they're not. We can't attack them.
Their names
may have been mentioned.
Well,
but
what are we sitting here for?
But they've not been accused of anything. All right,
I didn't accuse them of anything.
We're going to move on.
I only said what the Attorney General said. Yeah. That was in the newspaper and was also in the morning call.
All right. I think we should be careful what we read in the newspaper. Well, this is not the forum to raise those allegations.
I don't have to look and read anything. Why a person gives $80,000 to a mayor?
Wally.
What do you want for the $80,000? Why another person gives $22,000 to a mayor? What do you want with that? And then they don't want to pay the bills.
Wally, I got to call the meeting to order. I understand the point you're trying to make. This isn't the forum to do it, okay?
Yes.
We're going to move on unless there's any other questions for the auditor. Okay. Thank you, David, for your report. We're going to move on. The Environmental Advisory Council has sent us a late request to postpone their report, so we're going to defer to perhaps our next meeting if they're available to do that. We're going to move on then to ordinances for final passage. The first ordinance is Bill Number 34-2018, amending the City Code Chapter 180, Property Maintenance Code 180, Section 107.3, Method of Service Number 2, allowing services. Oh, this one has been withdrawn. I'm sorry. I apologize. The first ordinance is Bill 45-2018, acknowledging the amendment to the State Fireworks Law and amending the City Code Chapter 225 by banning the use of all fireworks within Reading unless permitted by the Reading Fire Department. This was introduced at the July 23rd regular meeting, and it was tabled at the August 13th regular meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments? John.
I support this. This is, of course, arose because of the new state legislation that made it easier to purchase aerial fireworks in the Commonwealth. And we have, over the 4th of July and throughout the summer, we have had quite a problem with fireworks in the city. And what this ordinance does, after a lot of vetting and by our fire department and others, it bans the use of aerial fireworks throughout the city, regardless of how close or distant it is from any dwelling. So it does not ban the use of sparklers. I know individuals can still use those. but it does ban the use of aerial fireworks, which are a fire hazard, a noise hazard, certainly, unless there is a permit for them, as it would be at the First Energy Stadium or some supervised fireworks display. So this is much needed. However, it will only be good as the enforcement and as the education to the public about this new ordinance. And I certainly hope that we will follow through on both of those elements. Thank you.
All right, any other comments? Marcia?
I fully support this legislation because I am concerned about the public safety issues related, and I believe people, when they saw that they could purchase fireworks and when that state law changed, you saw a lot more dangerous use of it. In fact, you know, driving through the city on the 4th of July, I could not get through certain city streets because people were setting off fireworks in the middle of the streets. I know our police department and our fire department did what they needed to do. They made arrests where they could, but they certainly don't have the manpower to be able to respond to a problem that's as serious. I do also, though, believe, just as with any change in ordinance, we need to do a comprehensive educational program that is both culturally sensitive, bilingual, to be able to help people understand, and to also understand that when this first when it's first passed, that we're not always going to have people be in compliance. So we need to let our police department use the common sense that they need to do to be able to address those issues that are severe as far as public safety goes, but also to be giving warnings to people. Again, I'm hoping that we have full cooperation from both the administration, I know we did from the fire chief in reviewing this. We need full cooperation of the administration to protect public safety. Thank you.
Any other comments? If not, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Marmer, seconded by Councilor Reed, to enact Bill Number 45, 2018, which bans the use of all fireworks within the city of Reading unless permitted by the fire department. Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Shihelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Slipko?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Waldman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Our next ordinance is Bill Number 46-2018, amending Code of the City of Reading, Chapter 576, Vehicles and Traffic, Part 4, Stopping and Parking, Section 576-815, to decrease the number of unsettled parking tickets exposing a motor vehicle to booting and storage. This was introduced at the July 23rd regular meeting and tabled at the August 13th regular meeting. Is there a motion, please?
Move to table.
I second.
There's been a motion to table. There is no discussion on a table motion. Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Slifko, seconded by Councilor Twyman, to table Bill Number 46-2018. Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmaru?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
No. Yes.
Ms. Shihelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Slifko?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Mr. Waldman, President?
No.
6 yeas, one nay.
Our next ordinance is Bill Number 47-2018, amending Code of the City of Reading, Chapter 576, Vehicles and Traffic, Part 4, Section 518A2 and Section 518A3, to increase time to appeal parking ticket and increase time to advise whether the parking ticket will be upheld or dismissed. This was introduced at the July 23rd regular meeting and tabled at the August 13th regular meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any discussion points? Any comments?
We had a little discussion about this in the committee of the whole. I see nothing wrong with this proposal. I really don't. It allows individuals more time to appeal through the administrative process, and it's a reasonable increase in time. I don't know exactly what it is, from 3 to 5 days. It seems to be a reasonable proposal.
All right, any other comments? Brian?
I just believe that serving our constituents is what we try to do, and certainly with the controversy surrounding the Reading Parking Authority, giving more residents and citizens a little bit more time really helps show the compassion and moving forward with what RPA wants to do.
Any other comments? Marcia?
Yes, again, I agree with Councilor Twyman. I believe people sometimes do need time. If they don't receive the notices in adequate time, there's a consequence for it. So I see no problem in extending the amount of time from the time that they're cited to the time they have to appeal.
All right. If there are no other comments, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Slivko, seconded by Councilor Twyman, to enact Bill Number 47, 2018, which increases the time to appeal for parking tickets. Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Shalnick?
Yes.
Mr. Slivko?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henderson?
Yes.
Mr. Marmarou?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Our next ordinance is Bill Number 51-2018, amending the 2018 capital budget by providing funding for the lease and purchase of 20 vehicles from Enterprise for property maintenance. This was introduced at the July 23rd meeting and tabled at the August 13th regular meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments?
The purpose of this is for the administration to do a test, as we indicated before, on our PMI and looking at a lease purchase program and being able to turn the vehicles over in a more timely fashion, and if the city chooses at that time at the end of the lease to sell the vehicles. Right now, our PMI fleet is made up of anywhere from a 2002 vehicle to the last purchase vehicle of 2014. Vehicles get anywhere from 14 miles to the gallon to up to 31. But the most of them are, we have at least seven vehicles, under 20 miles to the gallon. And with this purchase, allow us to have a fleet that has a stated high minimum city mileage of 31. Also, by keeping these older vehicles, we're putting money into the vehicles. One vehicle in particular in the last 3 years, $4,100 worth of parts have been put in the car. That is a 2006 Taurus, which I can probably tell you has a value of $500. So we're asking the council to move forward with this as part of a way to bring some efficiency to our vehicles budget and to save the city money. We're anticipating at the minimum we're going to be saving $15,000 a year in gas alone.
Any other comments? Right.
This is an excellent example of how metrical and sustainable information can really help an aid in making decisions. So I applaud the administration for this. It sounds really good based on the improved technology and improved progressiveness when we deal with the efficiency in vehicles. So I think this should aid in our budgetary and also the safety and productivity of our staff.
Okay. Any other comments? If not, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Marmarou, seconded by Councilor Reed, to enact Bill Number 51, 2018, which authorizes the purchase of 20 vehicles from Enterprise for property maintenance. Mm-hmm. Ms. Shalnick?
Yes.
Mr. Slivko?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henderson?
Yes.
Mr. Marmarou?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Our next ordinance is Bill 52, amending the City Code Chapter 396, Parks and Recreation, Part 3, Park Use, as attached, to correct and clarify the park code. Introduced at the August 13th regular meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments? John?
I support this for the reason that it allows cross enforcement on the Skyline area with Central Berks police force, and that will certainly aid in keeping these controlled up there if we have allowed cross enforcement by another municipality.
All right, any other comments? Marcia?
First of all, I want to thank both the city clerk and the collaboration we had also with our city solicitor to make sure that we have something that really keeps our parks and recreation areas safe. And the dusk to dawn regulation, the fact that we can now collaborate with Central Berks and the state police strengthens that. So the people who are using these facilities for the purpose that they're intended and not to be using them for unlawful types of activities. And that's what we really want to do. We want people to be able to come to these facilities and know that there's going to be safety. And I do, because I have so many of these areas in my district, do have consistent concerns presented to me by my constituents for those parks where we know that there is some misuse happening.
All right, if there's no other comments, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Reed, seconded by Councilor Goodman-Henschitz to enact Bill Number 52, 2018, which amends the City Parks Code. Mr. Slifko?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henschitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmarou?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Schehelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Our next ordinance is Bill Number 53-2018, replacing Bill Number 67-2017, restricting parking between the hours of 11 p.m. and 6 a.m. along both sides of Skyline Drive between the Pagoda and the city limits, and reaffirming that the Mount Penn Preserve area is closed between dusk and dawn. This was introduced at the August 13th regular meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
Properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments?
What is dusk and dawn? Do you know what time the sun goes down now, today?
It varies.
There are times stated in the
ordinance. Yeah. See, but which is it now? Do you have times that are stated in the ordinance, or do you have what dusk and dawn is?
Dusk and dawn
right now is around 8 o'clock, 8:30 at night that the sun goes down. It comes up between 5:30 and 6 o'clock in the morning.
Yep.
Okay? When the winter comes, it's gonna be doing 5, 6 o'clock at night that the sun goes down.
Yeah.
And it's gonna come up much more earlier. Mm-hmm. So do you want them driving around up there at 3 o'clock? It wouldn't break your ordinance.
No, I'm gonna ask the managing director just to kind of review the discretion discussion we had, as far as the police flexibility, just so everyone's clear on, we're not looking to penalize everybody, but there are expectations.
That for Mr. Shackman?
Okay. As we have discussed in earlier, all of this comes to officers' discretion, and if the person is up there and they want to see the sunset or go up and see the light shining over the city, the chief has said that he will ask his officers to use discretion. But if they're up there for a gathering purpose of a group of individuals and it's after dusk and they're playing loud music, obviously this gives the department the opportunity to move people away. But obviously I don't think anybody wants to discourage people from going up and seeing one of the greatest sights I think there is, is going up to the Pagoda and looking at the city at night. Right. I was up there the other day, the air was clear, you could see for miles. And it was probably the one time I've been up there during the day that you could see so far. And I can tell you, having gone up there at night, it is a spectacular view. But obviously, you're there for a quick look, appreciate, and obviously you should be going down the road. But hopefully that all of this will be done with proper discretion by our police department.
Donna, and then John.
And the dusk to dawn, which does change as the seasons change, is something that is used with most park departments, certainly used by the Berks County Parks Department, Muhlenberg Parks Department for the folks that were out there and saw the Riverfest event the other week or this past weekend. It's just a really traditional way to handle park visitors so that everyone's safe, the park itself is safe. And in this case, it is a public street, so it complicates matters. But if indeed this is enforced as it should be, more people should be able to enjoy the area and do so without feeling intimidated or having the peace of the beauty of nature destroyed, which is what has been happening.
John?
Yeah. I think we have to look at the big picture of what this ordinance is about. I mean, this is a result of numerous complaints. At our last council meeting, I don't know that I've seen so many citizens speak out about the noise problem that exists on the mountain. And we thought we had addressed it earlier in the summer, but the problem still continued. So after a lot of thought and debate and trying to respond to citizens' concerns, we are enacting legislation that will prohibit parking, standing between dusk to dawn on Skyline. Now, that doesn't mean that, as it's just been explained, that there will be some discretion in applying that for individuals who are clearly there for non-nefarious purposes. However, we need to make a a rather drastic change in what the regulation is for parking and standing from dusk to dawn on the mountain, and that's what this legislation does.
All right, Marcia.
And it was important that we pass this piece of legislation to be consistent with what we just adopted.
Right.
Okay, because they complement each other. And indeed, people who do want to go up, and there is activities up at the pagoda that do end after dusk, they will be in. They always have informed the police department when those activities are occurring, when there are rentals that occur, okay, that there might be activities. For instance, we do know that the Easter service does indeed start before dawn, so there will be people that will be up at William Penn Memorial Tower before dawn, okay, so that they can be there to watch the sunrise. So it's not as if we're excluding those positive community events. It's just that we want to be able to protect the neighborhood and the area surrounding. So we tried the other one, it didn't work, so now we're moving on to something different.
All right, Linda, can we have a...
Can I ask one question?
Yes.
Linda, did you say that there is a time that's in this ordinance that we're not looking at here?
Yes.
Dusk to dawn isn't 11 o'clock till 6 in the morning.
Yes, under
but
the
she
time,
said there is a time
of use section, parks are open 7 a.m. to 7 p.m. prevailing time, October 1st through April 30th, and 7 a.m. to 9 p.m. May 1st through September 30th, except with a permit.
Is that what's going to be applied to this then?
Yep.
Okay.
Any other comments? Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Goodman-Hinderschitt, seconded by Councilor Reed, to enact Bill Number 53, 2018, which repeals the parking restrictions applied to Skyline Drive. Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Hinderschitt?
Yes.
Mr. Marmorou?
Yes, but that should be 2014, not 2018.
2017.
Yep.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Schehelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Slifko?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Our next ordinance is Bill Number 54-2018, amending the general fund budget to provide in the amount of $65,000 to provide the funds needed to pay for additional costs associated with a contract for electrical and supplier and distributor costs. This was introduced at the August 13th regular meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments?
Yes, as I said earlier, this was a, this issue goes back to when the city bid out its electrical purchase, and this is just one small account. There are other accounts that total up for all of our electric. In these particular accounts, some of these lines were not transferred. We were just recently notified that several months ago that we owed this money, and obviously we're going to have to pay this out of current operating year expenses.
Okay, any comments or questions? If not, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Counselor Goodman Henderson, seconded by Counselor Slifko, to enact Bill Number 54, 2018, which amends the 2018 budget to provide for additional electrical costs. Ms. Goodman Henderson?
Yes.
Mr. Marmarou?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Schehalneck?
Yes.
Mr. Slifko?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
Seven yeas, no nays.
Our next ordinance is Bill Number 55-2018, approving the First Amendment to the lease agreement with the Reading Area Water Authority approved on June 12, 2017 by increasing the city's meter surcharge payment to $1.7 million annually as attached in Exhibit A. This was introduced at the August 13th regular meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments?
Yes, as I...
Brian or Strat? It was pretty close.
It was me.
No, it was Marcia.
It was my second, Marcia.
Oh, it was Marcia?
Yeah.
They both said it at the same time, so...
As I said earlier in the Committee of the Whole, this is a requirement by essentially an accounting requirement. We were receiving a $1.7 million payment from RAWA, but it was not reflected in the new lease agreement that was developed, I guess, now 2 years ago. And for them to properly pay us, we need an amendment to the agreement.
Okay. Any other comments? John?
This, even though it says $1.7 million, that it is no increased revenue nor increased expense for the city. This is just simply aligning the words of the lease with what has already been agreed.
Any other comments? If not, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Slifko, seconded by Councilor Goodman Henderson, to enact Bill Number 55-2018, which amends the lease with the Reading Area Water Authority. Mr. Marmarou?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Schehalneck?
Yes.
Mr. Slifko?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman Henderson?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
Seven yeas, no nays.
Our final ordinance for passage this evening is Bill.
Will you go back to that, Jay? Mr. Slifko, basically, you're stating it doesn't increase anything. Then why do you have the wording in here by increasing the city's meter surcharge payment to 1.7 annually?
Well, I'm going to defer to Glenn Wally because it's just increasing the wording is being spelled out to add clarity. It's not an actual increase in the revenue.
Jeff,
I still think your wording is wrong.
I want to make it very clear so the mayor understands this wording came from the administration, not from council.
I didn't say it did. You're voting on it, though. You should have asked.
Yeah, but then that's why your administrator needs to explain it.
Why is it in there? That makes every person out there believe that you are increasing it and they think they pay enough.
Again, the wording, Mr. Steckman, can you explain that?
And you have the opportunity to
I'm trying to find it in the packet. And the wording actually was not supplied by the staff. It was, you know, we were depending on RAWA's attorney, and I'm sure it's not. I'm going to have to find, because I believe.
If you look at the actual ordinance, it just spells out the clarification of it. So you're right, Mayor, it shouldn't say increase. It's reflected as an increase in a meter surcharge, but what happens at the same time is the overall payment is reduced by that. So it's just splitting out the surcharge, if you will, from the current lease payment.
I think you should just make a motion to remove the word increasing.
You're okay? It's already passed.
Well,
yeah, it's just the heading. That's not on the ordinance. Okay. But I agree, it does offer confusion. All right, we're going to move on to Ordinance K.
Now, Council President, I just want a clarification because we spend a lot of time in Committee of the Whole going over this. So I would ask the mayor if you could be at least consulting with your managing director or attending the Committee of the Whole, and that way you would be aware of the nuances of the language as it's been clarified.
Marcia, could I ask you again? Every time I've come to the Committee of the Whole meeting, I ask questions and no one answers me. Mm-hmm. I just sit there. It's almost like, I don't know, maybe you're all investigating the reporters or something around here, but that's how I feel, like somebody runs this council and you decide not to talk with me. I mean, I got to say that Brian spoke up the last time asking why I don't come, and I've told you why, but that's the reason why I don't come. What am I wasting my time for?
Well, we're not going to solve that tonight. I can tell you, Wally, if you do come, I will encourage everyone to respond. I think that's fair.
And you're all still welcome to come see me.
Sure, absolutely. I agree with that as well. All right, our final ordinance this evening is Bill 56-2018, amending the budget to provide the funds needed to pay for additional costs associated with contracted services work needed for city vehicles, which are outsourced by the city's garage division. The funds will be paid by reallocation of both Public Works and Fire Department budgeted funds in the amount of $70,000. This was introduced at the August 13th regular meeting. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments?
This is a budget amendment. As the fire chief told you, we are experiencing more repairs needed for our fire trucks. Specifically, a lot of it is related to the emissions control system, which is, because of federal regulations, has become very expensive on fire trucks to maintain.
Okay. Any other comments or questions? If not, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Slivko, seconded by Councilor Reed, to enact Bill Number 56-2018, which amends the budget to provide for additional vehicle repairs. Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Shehelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Slivko?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Govan-Henishek?
Yes.
Mr. Marmorou?
Yes.
Mr. Waldman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
All right, we have two ordinances for introduction this evening. I'm going to ask that Councilwoman Marcia Goodman-Henderson to please read them onto the record.
Okay. A, ordinance authorizing the creation of a OPEC other post-employment benefits trust agreement to provide for certain post-employment benefits for employees hired prior to January 1st, 2011 as attached in Exhibit A. B, ordinance authorizing the issuance of a residential parking permit for the 100 block of Moore Street.
Thank you, Marcia. We have four resolutions. The first resolution this evening is Resolution 87-2018, approving a lease purchase agreement with Enterprise Fleet Management. This was tabled at the July 23rd and August 13th regular meetings. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. We already approved the budgeted items for this a little earlier. So are there any additional comments or questions at this time? If not, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Goodman-Henderson, seconded by Councilor Slivko, to adopt Resolution 87-2018, which approves a lease agreement purchase of vehicles with Enterprise Fleet. Ms. Shehelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Slivko?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henderson?
Yes.
Mr. Marmorou?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Mr. Waldman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Our next resolution is for the appointment of Lee Olson to the Planning Commission. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments?
Yeah, here's a gentleman that everyone in the city, everyone in Berks County knows. He has stepped forth every time we need somebody in a position of importance, he's right up there, and I recommend him hire.
Any other comments? John?
I just wish we could clone Mr. Olson, you know, and put him on five or six boards and commissions. He is a great asset to the city. He's served on many boards and commissions. The only downside to this is that he's going to have to resign from the Blighted Property Review Committee.
Yes.
Because of a rule we have that you can only serve on one. But we thank Mr. Olson for his service, and we're very grateful to have it.
All right, if there are no other comments, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Marmorou, seconded by Councilor Twyman, to adopt Resolution 93-2018. Which appoints Lee Olson to the Planning Commission. Mr. Slivko?
Yes.
Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henderson?
Yes.
Mr. Marmorou?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Shehelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Waldman, President?
Yes.
7 yeas, no nays.
Our next resolution is removing Kevin Graybill from the First Energy Stadium Commission. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments?
Yes. Here's a gentleman that has... He's missed so many meetings, and you can't get in touch with him. If he's not interested, pick up the phone and let us know. Don't just avoid coming to the meetings, and we have to sit there sometimes to worry if we're going to have a quorum. So it was decided at our last meeting to remove him from the board.
Any other comments? If not, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Marmarou, seconded by Councilor Twyman, to adopt Resolution 94-2018, which removes Kevin Graybill from the First Energy Stadium Commission. Mr. Twyman?
Yes.
Ms. Goodman-Henshitz?
Yes.
Mr. Marmarou?
Yes.
Ms. Reed?
Yes.
Ms. Schelnick?
Yes.
Mr. Slifko?
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President?
Yes.
Seven yeas, no nays.
Final resolution is respectfully requesting the mayor to advise the Reading Parking Authority Executive Director and Board to immediately open their records for an audit by the Pennsylvania Auditor General. Is there a motion, please?
So moved.
Second.
It's been properly moved and seconded. Are there any comments? Yes, Donna.
And actually, this also is an and/or. It's requesting the mayor to advise this action. It's also requesting the executive director and the board of the parking authority to do this as well, to open their books to make the entry to the auditor general. It is something that I believe will help the transparency, and if we're all on the same page, this is great. This is just formalizing our request.
Any other comments? Marcia?
And I felt by the attendance of both David Sitook and myself at the last Parking Authority meeting, even though this directly didn't come up, I believe that they understand the purpose of this, and it's a look back on records to different administrations and different parking authority members and different people who handled the finances of the parking authority. Because of some ongoing concerns that I cannot speak for parking authority members, but I know that there are some concerns there. So this is bringing the expertise of this the Auditor General, who indeed has looked very closely and drilled down with the Reading School District, plus other entities across the board, is doing that now with the Philadelphia Parking Authority. It can be helpful. It is not something that's intended to look at whether there was any criminal malfeasance, but just how the Parking Authority can better move forward considering some of the past practices.
Brian?
This cooperative effort will show not only transparency, but the cooperation that we can provide in Reading, Pennsylvania, first and foremost. But secondly, as the RPA is going to be so integral in the commercial resurgence of downtown Reading, and the cooperation related to economic development exists so much there, that's where the importance is. So I hope that we can all work together on that, and this will be very successful.
Any other comments? So I'm going to defer. John, did you have a comment?
Sort of echoing really what we said here. I mean, this is not like a judgment on the Reading Parking Authority. It is allowing the expert resources of a body that is well versed in this, and the Reading Parking Authority does not have the resources to look back and find out what things might have gone right or wrong in the past 4 to 8 years or whatever. The Auditor General does, and I think we should utilize or ask that his services be utilized for the betterment of the whole authority.
All right, I'm gonna.
Can I just tell you that? Have you noticed I'm not arguing with that?
I got you, but I
just hope that you all like the great job that I'm sure they're going to do, because many times I've asked you to read that contract with the DoubleTree Garage, and no one here would. So enjoy yourselves. Wait till you find out. When you talk about fiduciary responsibility, that responsibility was to all those board members that sat there and signed that contract, and the one for Second and Washington Streets. It's unbelievable.
So, you know, my position, I feel this way. I feel that, A, the board is in place. They told us tonight they're waiting for their audit. They will make a decision at that time. They were not opposed, from what I hear, to bringing in the Pennsylvania Auditor General. The mayor has already made the request of all the board members on all three authorities. You know, I affirm what the mayor's already done. I don't feel the need to, via resolution, to ask him to do something he's already done. And we've already asked board members in person to do so as well. That's in their purview to do that. My hope is they will do that. I do believe some of the issues that the mayor brought up this evening probably even more importantly need some closer eyes than some of the litigation we've had. So I don't want to be the oddball out here, but I'm going to be. And I will also tell you, I'm going to have some comments during the council comment period regarding the released audit results of the Reading School District. And they're not meant to be critical, but they're meant to be just my observations. And I just think, you know, when we audit for things, we should audit for everything. And, you know, I think we have to be clear. So are there any other comments, Marcia?
Well, I think Donna first, and then I'll speak.
I'm sorry, Donna.
Well, if it was up to me, I'd say open the books to everything about everything, because everything we do is public money.
Right.
And all the books should all be thrown open to whomever would like to see them. So I think we should all be in agreement on that. And also, council is a partner in this government, and we have the right to request something. We're not, again, we're doing it respectfully, but we are a partner in city government, and we have an obligation to our constituents to express our beliefs and our concerns.
Marcia?
And I look at audits as not looking at, oh, what are we going to discover so we can point fingers and be negative to people? I look at it as a constructive process to gather data that said what worked and what didn't, so we can move forward in the best way possible for all our assets. And so in that way, and I believe the issue of asking for it came up after Councillor Reed met with the Auditor General and provided feedback to us, and then, of course, being able to attend the Parking Authority, it doesn't discount us needing to look at this in all other entities and all other ways, because, of course, as city government, we are accountable to the public to be as transparent, as open as possible for any transaction. So I look forward to us having future discussions. And, you know, as far as what might have happened with the Reading School District, it's for us to work with them as they are attempting to put their ship in the right place, rather than, again, being negative. We look at it in a productive way. I'm always looking at things strength-based, not tearing things down.
And I agree with all that. I'm sorry, Lucien, before you go. But the mayor has told us publicly and tonight that he's already made that request. I just, sometimes these affirmations and reaffirmations get a little too deep for me. Go ahead, Lucy.
So several of our authorities have been in positions and circumstances where their struggles have come up. And as a council body, we, you know, are approached by constituents asking, you know, what can you do? How can you help? And without wanting to interfere in the businesses of the authorities, this is a way that we can try to help them. And that's where the support comes for this.
Yeah, and I agree with that, Lucine. I think we've done them both. We've asked the mayor. He's already told us he's made that request. We've asked the board. They've already told us they'll consider it. I don't know that doing it on the platform of a resolution is necessary, but I'm just one person. Go ahead, Don.
And as state law exists now, it's up to the authorities themselves to make this request.
Absolutely.
It is not the mayor or council ordering redevelopment or anything. They're autonomous authorities, they're autonomous bodies. There is legislation, and I believe it's just squandering in committee in the Senate, regarding the ability of the Auditor General to go forward and audit authorities. It's not going anywhere. So I think any body like ours, any official in a specific capacity to advise or encourage an authority to do this, has that obligation to the taxpayers. Again, maybe the Municipal League should get together and try to exert some influence on that legislation that would then enable the State Auditor General to go in without an invitation. But at this point, the authorities have to be willing to open up their books under the law as it is now.
And if any constituent approaches me, I'm going to let them know I've spoken with the Parking Authority. I've asked them to consider that request, and the mayor has informed me directly that he's asked them to do the same. So I've done my part as a legislative member.
Can I just get something in quick?
Yeah. We got Marcia.
All right, I'll let Marcia go. I'm going to listen.
And I think it says to the strength that we're all on the same page here, the Parking Authority, the mayor, and city council. So we're really reaffirming what each of us wants to have happen. So in that way, I think if we didn't pass this resolution, we wouldn't be affirming that publicly. And that's what I want to see happen.
Mayor.
Mayor now.
Yeah.
How do you like Facebook, you people? Go listen to what you say on Facebook. You say you welcome this, and then you tell Craig Poole, oh, you call us right away if anybody gives you a hard time on Facebook.
All right, Wally.
Wait, hang on, say one thing here, but you forget Facebook's there forever, and go into Craig Poole's down there at the Doubletree and see what these council people say. I'm not pointing to you, but I sure can look at you, okay?
Well, Wally, I want to stay away from
that. So while you say this here, you're against the people of the city of Reading when you start telling, oh, what you're doing is a great job, you're doing this. We lose $1.4 million a year in that parking lot, and the people of the city of Reading have to pay it. What does it take? Hopefully the Auditor General, you'll believe him. Why were these contracts ever signed?
Okay, Wally, you're going too broad on this resolution.
All right, I'll slow down, but all I'm saying to you is this. Look at what pay to play is. Look at who's gaining from this and how much they've given to political campaigns. Come on, they even say
all
that.
All right, Wally,
I just don't get it.
Just pulling everyone into the context of this
I'm
resolution.
I'm just asking council, please, really look to your heart. Are you fighting me and the people of the city of Reading because you like somebody?
Wally, okay, we're done with the discussion.
Stop.
Are there any other comments on the resolution itself? If not, Linda, can we have a roll call, please?
Motion was made by Councilor Reed, seconded by Councilor Twyman, to adopt Resolution 95-2018, which respectfully asks the mayor to order the Parking Authority Board and Director to open their records for and notify the PA Auditor General.
Advise.
The word is changed to advise.
Yeah, I changed it to advise because I was incorrect.
No, I'm saying
it's a description. It's not what the legislature.
All right, guys, we're not going to fight at the table. Marcia, roll call, please.
Yes. Mr. Marmaru.
Yes.
Ms. Reed.
Yes.
Ms. Shahelnick.
Yes.
Mr. Slifko.
Yes.
Mr. Twyman.
Yes.
Mr. Waltman, President.
No.
Six yeas, one nay.
All right, we're going to move on to council comments. The floor is open. Anybody have comments? Make them very gentle tonight, if you could. I'm only kidding. John.
Two brief comments. I'd like to thank and congratulate all the people who came together yesterday at the Essex Playground at Ole and 6th Street. There was probably about 100 kids there for a block party with a purpose, and the purpose was to promote bike safety. We had there the bike patrol of the Reading Police. We had state troopers there. We had Jason Orth from the Bike Hub, who volunteered his services, and he was the Wonder Man there who fixed all these kids' bikes there. We had a bike wash, food, a number of churches were present. And I particularly want to thank the residents of the 700 block of Church Street that pulled this all together. We'll be holding something similar in October. They did an excellent job, and I appreciate it. The second thing I'd like to just report on was that last Wednesday and Thursday, several of us appeared at a hearing in Harrisburg on the UGI gas meter case. I think we did very well. We will not have a decision until January. UGI did well too, I'm not going to deny that, but I think you could be proud of the presentation that we made, and let's keep our fingers crossed. Thank you.
Any other comments? Lucine, then Donna.
I just want to thank our citizens, those of you who are still here, attending our meetings. It's very important for us to hear directly from you. Especially to the two young women, to the Beauty with Brains. I think that is so important, and working with 5th to 8th graders is a very vulnerable time for women, and to help them become confident leaders and strive in their academics and also expose them to motivational speakers is a wonderful, wonderful thing.
Donna?
I think one thing we didn't address today, I mean, everyone sees us sit here, and we certainly discuss our legislation, and we talk amongst ourselves. But while we're doing this, out on the streets of the city of Reading in the last year, there's been 30-plus shootings, including a murder this morning. I have ultimate confidence in our police department. I believe they're doing the best they can. But for police to be fighting crime, they need to be out in the streets. You know, we were surprised by the announcement or finding out there was a substation being created at Fifth and Penn. It's not necessarily wrong. But is it more important to have people in that substation or more important to have feet on a street? I'm asking that as a question. I don't know the answer to it. All I know is that another young man of our city is dead, shot. We had a wonderful meeting with the Moms Demand Action. Mr. Zabala's back there. He was helpful in that. Mr. Guzman. It was an honest, open meeting. I appreciate the police chief being there, the residents there, some of whom have lost loved ones to gun violence. This is going on in this town. We can talk about prettying things up. We can debate legislation. We can talk about audits, which are very, very important. But the bottom line is, what's more important than the human beings of the city, the kids, the youth of the city? When you see multiple times of 20-something young men being gunned down, whether it's four of them at once on South 3rd Street or one by one by one through the streets of Reading, something is inherently wrong. I would like to know more within the reason, because I understand police work, what is going on to keep our city safer and what we can do as a body or as administration regarding the gun violence that is becoming increasingly prevalent in this town. We can talk all we want here, but I sure hope that when I leave here, I don't see that another person has been shot or killed because of gun violence in this city. We need feet on the street. We need people to help each other out. We need neighborhoods to be cohesive. No matter what our cultural differences are, what our economic differences are, we have to make this a safer city, and we're not doing a real good job of it right now.
Any other comments? Brian.
I just want to speak to match John's sentiments about the goodness that happened this weekend at Essex Park. I mean, it was just really nice to see that many children and that many people together for a good cause. Of course, Jason North and the Bike Hub and the churches involved and the individuals, they did a really, really cool thing. I didn't see too many upset faces. Everybody was smiling, and there was lots of opportunity. So as citizens and constituents, please continue with the grassroots efforts to do these things. John and I had nothing to do with developing that program. They did it themselves, and that's how we build excitement and wanting to be involved in the city. So hats off to them. Really quickly, and I find myself at a point where it's surprising that I would say this, being that we have all of the council people, and they'll probably say the same thing, but I thought long and hard about the death of John McCain, and only because I knew in the end of what I read of him, he was bipartisan. And I think that's what we all kind of strive for, is though even though we disagree, there's lots of areas to agree upon. And he stood up as a patriot in his life, and his life story is known to a lot of people. So it was pretty interesting to me to hear, you know, his statements at the end was, look, we must continue, but we must remain patriots, and we must be responsible and inclusive in our government. And that's what it's all about. And along those lines of patriotism, I want to continue to encourage not the position of what some of these individuals, since football season is starting, choose to take as far as kneeling, but the real point is that young men are acknowledging what's been going on in the urban community, people of color, young black men, for many, many, many years, and what they're doing is they're executing their right to have nonviolent protest, and I think that's just being missed in the whole conversation. As for Juan Zabala, thank you. Keep coming. Again, the chamber is almost empty, but everybody was here, and I wanted to hold my comments to the end out of respect, because I could say all this in the beginning, but we had so much dialogue that sometimes it doesn't get to that point. So I just wanted to say, you know, hats off to the constituents that continue to come every week. Juan, keep saying what you're saying. You know, I might disagree with you on a lot of points, but I still want to hear what you have to say. And the more people you speak to, it gets us all thinking and involved. So continue to do the same thing. As for the RPA, I just think they need to be a part of the solution, and the transparency of openness, I think it's been demonstrated by the mayor and the members of the board, so we can move in the right direction. I just think that we need to remember that it's a tool, but it doesn't have to be a painful tool for our constituents. And there's a lot of ways to help, and there's a lot of ways to enforce. I'm not against enforcement, but we need to have proper administration and process in order to do that, because RPA can help with the commercial resurgence of downtown Reading. They're a big partner in this. A gentleman came in who we interviewed today. Hats off to the people that are trying to be a part of this downtown revitalization effort. And they both said, hey, you know, the problem is parking. And we know this. That's the problem, is that we know parking is the problem. It is, and it will continue to be until we get a good answer. So to those gentlemen that came in today, thank you very much. You're doing a great job. Last, but not least, the two young ladies, that's the definition of entering into a service project at a very, very young age. And hats off to them. If I can help in any way, please reach out to me. I know everybody at this table shares that. And to George, I think the spotted liner fry is like his great white whale. I mean, he continues to talk about it. He continues to keep up the effort to tell people that there is a problem going on with it. And it's just like a lot of us feel like we can't control or act upon an issue. Just being involved or just speaking out about it will really, really aid in that. So, George, hats off, and thank you for continuing to talk about the spotted liner fry. You know, it is a problem. And I think tomorrow at 8:30 in the morning, the Ag Extension is having a meeting in the city, and they're moving out all around the county to educate more people and just kind of have a collective of people. So can I ask that?
I'm going to that.
Yeah, so Donna, I don't know if you can explain. I don't know all the exact details.
I'll be happy to report back to council on it.
So we will have people involved. So if you're in, call the Ag Extension early. They may have already had reservations, but I know they're not going to turn away people who are interested in talking about this.
Yeah, and there's two buses, so they'll have a finite amount of seats. So.
Thank you very much. So thank you to all the community, and continue to come to these meetings because we need you informed and educated. Thank you.
Marcia.
And I want to start out with, I think the strength of our democracy is we have people working at the grassroots level, the folks that sit on our authorities, the folks that come out to be able to speak up, which I really respect when they come here, and then what we do at our level legislatively and what the administration does at their level. All of them are important, and then that moves up to our state legislator. The things that have happened in my area have been outstanding as far as grassroots level. I see the young people continuing to want to be good citizens and coming and speaking out when they see crimes are committed, and taking the opportunity to communicate with the adults who were there to protect them. And I want to give a shout out to the Reading Police Department in a way that they were able to show to those young people when they make a concern, it's worthwhile. When I see things not going so right, I communicate, and I want to thank Mr. Steckman for listening to the times that I communicate with him and taking the action that's needed in order to be able to maybe correct some things that didn't happen quite their way. But what I saw happening today was just outstanding. When I saw the first day of school and the way the parents were getting their children ready, how many times I saw parents taking pictures of their children as they were getting ready. I saw Pastor Kaler handing out pencils to the children as they walked by the church on the way to 16th and Hawk. All those were very touching. I expressed my concerns through email about some of the safety issues we have along Perkiomen Avenue, where children can't cross the street onto pavements because there are barriers there for the curbs being fixed, and that's a very dangerous situation. I know I spoke about that earlier. The administration will be addressing that. I saw at a grassroots level the moms against gun violence and the young people who are terrified that they think that gun violence might strike their school. When you heard their voices and, you know, you heard some of the communication that needs to be improved with the Reading Police Department. But I agree with Councilor Reed. This is becoming epidemic again as far as the gun violence in our city and across the country. And we need to speak with the chief, but also concerned citizens about how we can pull together and be able to address this. I have one tiny part of a solution to the problem, and I'm going to be working with the Reading School District and setting up some training for those young people who want to have a voice and have them learn how their voice can be heard and how we can have better communication. But that's only one small piece. We all need to work together. What I would suggest, and we did this years ago when the problem was that serious, and it was before I came on council, but people came forward. We were able to have a good meeting with the Criminal Justice Advisory Board and with all our leaders in the community. We need to talk about what the problem is and what the solutions are. And I think that's just as important as what we're needing to do with economic development, because if people don't feel safe, if they feel their basic needs and if they feel their lives are threatened, they're not going to know what to do. So hopefully we can make that an agenda, Council President, on our Committee of the Whole meetings to be able to discuss where we need to go. Mayor, I really would hope that, I know you say sometimes you're not listened to, come to the meeting.
I'm not listening to it at all.
But I really feel that we all need to be part of this dialogue, okay, and how it happens. We made pass some ordinances tonight which just attack a small part of that problem, but we need to all be on the same page here. So I really am reaching out because we're talking about the lives of our citizens and they need to be protected.
Can I address that substation that you were asking about, everybody?
What was that?
The one down on Penn Street, the substation for the police department.
If you pull the microphone up, Wally, and give us a concise kind of overview of that.
I don't print the Eagle Times, and I don't call them, they call me. But there are people who like to call them as soon as they see something happening rather than call me, okay? But you have a substation at 8th and Cherry Street that's never open. Just about any of the merchants I talked to downtown, I found out that it's a bicycle station where you can basically, where the policemen that are on bikes go there and you have one patrol car. Those bikes aren't the bikes that are taking care of the community downtown, okay? So one of the big things I think that I should say to you is that we had a couple people, and we might still have people that want to do pop-ups for Christmas. First thing they asked about was safety, and I said to them, I'm trying to put a substation downtown. I was trying for the post office, and I hope someday we still get that. But at this point, I'll try to do my best that I give them some visibility rather than just being in the back where the buses come in and go, okay? So I thought if we can get them downtown and get the bicycle policemen, that's what I'm looking at, nothing else. We're not taking anybody from anywhere. They still have everywhere that they normally do their traveling. It's just that you have a better presence in Penn Square. Because if I want to get somebody in that side building there, it's huge. First question is asked of me is, how's the police protection downtown? I like to tell them there, I don't see a problem downtown ever. But rather than argue with them, I'll make them more visible in the downtown area by removing them from Cherry Street and putting them out in the public's front. Plus, we have a parking lot in the back if we needed to park cars back there, police cars or whatever, that we own the property, we, the people of the city of Reading. So there's nothing stopping us from using it or doing something with it, especially if it'll be a great draw. So that's what happened there. And when I said that I held it close to my chest, I held it close to my chest because people try to destroy anything that the wrong person brings before them. So, but I plan on just doing what I think is very progressive and positive for the people of the city of Reading. The other one I wanted to ask you is, I just heard this for the first time tonight, and so did Glenn. We've been working diligently with the UGI. We don't even know about this meeting. Who went to the meeting, and who did you go representing?
Well, JD and Osmer were there, and this was the hearing that had been scheduled for months.
But we gave the demands already, written demands, correct? Did they adhere to them? I never heard nothing from you folks.
A written testimony, and then the parties also had the option to follow up, to supplement with live testimony, which we did before that day last week.
Okay, but here I am on Monday listening to someone else telling the administration you had a meeting. The second thing is, did they agree that not only the historic districts, they will treat everyone in the city of Reading the same?
Absolutely.
Okay, wasn't that something we as the administration wrote and gave it to the man?
Absolutely.
Okay, so we would have liked to be informed about it.
you're the city solicitor. I pick you, but even if I let Glenn talk with you about everything, we ought to know what you're doing, not a councilman telling us. The administration is the one that argues the point. We lost $300,000 because the administration wasn't involved before. I don't want to be in that position ever again.
Okay.
All I'm asking you is inform the administration. That's who you work for. And you still at the same time work for city council. But the administration is the one that has been negotiating. We took a lot of time that afternoon down there in your office down there with the people from that were going to argue on our behalf from the law firm. And to hear it today that you had a meeting without us with all the input we gave you is very disappointing. Not with you, John, but with my solicitor. You should have told us. We shouldn't be hearing it today.
Wally, I'm going to ask you guys to defer that to a meeting. I would recommend you guys clarify that.
If I may, I just have one thing left. If you don't mind, I don't want to wait because I've heard the testimony and I've read it if it's accurate. I'm going to reach out as the mayor of the city of Reading along with the city administrator, I'm going to ask him also to sign it, to the auditor general to come here quick before this trial is over because what we're hearing isn't what we have in our deposition.
And I think that's in your purview to do that.
Really good. Yeah. So I'll be doing that, and I'm not doing it behind your back. I've asked you if you would do it first. Yeah. Okay?
Okay. Any other comments? And I have a couple comments. I'll try to be brief. You know, I heard the discussion about homelessness and the shootings, you know, the rooming houses. And, you know, I took time today to look at the state auditor general's report on the Reading School District. And the financial issues that were outlined, I guess, a year or two ago were resolved. But what stood out to me, and this is in no way meant to be critical of the administration, of the school board, of all the wonderful teachers in the Reading School District, just as we don't do things perfectly, I'm sure there's always little things they can do better, but I know they do as good a job as they can do. They have a monumental task of trying to educate a lot of transient students. And in some cases, you know, non-English speaking students. So they have a huge task, but it concerns me, and the latest numbers they have are the 2015-2016 numbers. Just take a look at them. I mean, take a look. This is where they need our support, all of them, to try to improve those numbers, and it starts in the home, it starts in the school. But if those numbers don't improve, we're looking at a lot of shootings, we're looking at a lot of homelessness, you know, we're looking at things that we can't control. So early education to me is absolutely critical. I hope the school district can, and I'm sure they've improved these numbers since 2016, but I hope they can continue to improve them. I hope the state can continue to support them. Every dollar that we spend in our school district is critical to the success of our city. There is nothing more important in this city than the education of these young kids. If it were up to me, there wouldn't be more than 10 kids in a classroom in first grade through third grade. I don't think anybody should leave third grade until they're proficient in reading, spelling, and math. I just absolutely believe that. And, you know, I think it was fine to celebrate the financial successes that they had. I also believe at the same time they need everyone's support in their efforts to try to educate these kids, and whatever we can do to make the streets safer, to make the pathways to school safer, I think is absolutely critical. We all have a hand in it. I was a Reading School District student from Thomas Ford to Northwest Junior High. I got an excellent education, and I think every student in our city deserves that same education to give them a platform to move forward on. So I just want to tie that in. You know, we had 215 police officers 7, 8, 9 years ago, and we had 27 murders, I believe, in that 1 year when we were almost nearly fully staffed. It takes economic development, it takes education, it takes codes enforcement, it takes city government, it takes people who live in the neighborhoods, all to work together. There's no one solution. You could have 300 police and a lot more shootings. And there's one other issue I want to bring up. I mean, we didn't have time to talk about it tonight, but we need to talk about these street bikes and these motorcycles.
Thank you.
I witnessed something on Saturday where two motorcycles, not licensed, raced up Spring Street, One was going against traffic, drove right up the sidewalk for half a block at full speed with somebody riding on the back. And the time has come in the coming weeks, and I don't know the answers, Wally, and I know you don't support that kind of behavior.
Well, it's tough to...
It's tough, but we've got to find some solutions that...
I stopped one kid that was on it, okay? He was only 16 years old. He just came here. He was on a motorcycle at the age of 12 and 11 where he came from.
Right.
To them, they don't feel like they're violating a law. And yeah, it's like they're out in joyriding. But these guys that are going up in the air with the bikes, coming up close to you, I've seen it.
You know what?
They've done it to me.
It's unacceptable. What you did where you came from, if that was allowed...
I know, but that's where
certainly,
education...
If you want to go do that, then go back where you came from. But in the city of Reading, if we want to bring companies and jobs and we want our kids to be well-educated, yeah, we can't have them ran over by motorcycles on our sidewalks.
I agree.
It is unacceptable, and everyone in this community has to step up and help. And I don't care if we have to offer rewards. We're going to have to come up with solutions. Somebody's going to get killed. You could be
walking. School district. Yeah. We need the school district.
We need everybody. We need it. And this wasn't a 16-year-old I saw, by the way. This was somebody in his 20s and 30s acting like they were 12.
16-year-old kid, I was surprised. But let me say this to you, and I don't mean this in the wrong way. I was crossing 9th Street, and as I was going down, he came flying down. He realized who I was and recognized me. He says, "Sorry, Wally." That tells me I can talk to you because he called me Wally. And then basically 16 years old, and he was a kid. But I said to him, "You know, you're a kid that can die on the road here. And you really got to think about it, what's taking place, because there's a lot of other bikes coming ahead of you that are doing terrible things." But he was doing a bad thing, too. Yeah. He had his bike up in the air. And I just talked to him, and you may say, "Well, why didn't I tell him to get off his bike and get going?" I was just happy that I talked to him. He did get off it without me asking him. He probably got back on it. I didn't look back. But it just shows you that
do me a favor next time. Wally, do me a favor next time. Call the police. I hate to say it, because these people, until we get this issue under control, somebody's going to get hurt. Mm-hmm. And what I saw Saturday night is unbelievable. Marcia?
Yeah, and I thank you for reaching out. I have to say that things have improved slightly in my area, but it doesn't mean that other people will start coming up. And unless we have a clear message to these folks, it's already on the books. Unlicensed vehicles are not allowed. We already have the laws. We just have to figure out how to enforce them.
Okay. Are there any other comments? All right, can we have a motion to adjourn?
You got it.
Thank you.